Hello, beautiful creative people. Welcome to howtoartjournal.com. I'm Kiala Givehand, your creative tour guide. And in this interview, I chat with Amanda Trought, a mixed media artist in the truest sense. Amanda paints, writes, blogs, draws, crochets, crafts, dances, sculpts, and takes photographs. In 2007, she found mixed media art and began taking classes. Amanda believes you have to make time for art. She works with art and health organizations to spread the word about how art and creativity can impact conditions of dementia patients. Amanda's art has been featured in multiple books and on crescendo.com, and she's exhibited her art in and around London. Currently living in Barbados, Amanda teaches online and shares tutorials on her YouTube channel and blog. One of the things I really love about Amanda is the way she helps us move from fearing our inner critic to embracing it. Her website is an amazing resource, and she's constantly inspiring other creatives to find their creative voice. Listen in as we talk about art, life, and embracing the inner critic. Hello, hello, and welcome. Amanda, I am so thrilled that I'm getting to interview you. I feel like this is something I've been building up to for a really long time. I know that probably sounds crazy to you, but you're definitely someone that I've followed in, you know, the online space and have secretly been saying, oh my God, one day I want to interview her and talk to her and see what it is, you know, that keeps her inspired and keeps her going. So I'm really, really delighted to be able to have the chance to talk to you. So thank you. Thank you for joining.
Thank you for having me. It's a pleasure. And likewise, as I say, you know, you've been one of the people that I followed online as well. And so this moment is quite a precious one for me.
Oh, thank you. That feels so awesome. So everybody who's listening to the recording after, you know, after the fact, I will give you two pieces of little things you need to keep in mind. Amanda is overseas. We are in two completely different parts of the world. And so there's a little bit of lag time on our video. So as you're listening in, just know if you hear pauses, it's because we've got a little bit of lag time. But we are still going to keep going because I'm excited to talk to her, and no lag time is going to keep me from that. So so we'll jump right in with the first question. Amanda, tell us what brought you to art journaling.
What brought me to art journaling? Well, I started out as an artist working just in, I was doing portraits, and I wanted to learn how to draw from my imagination, but I also wanted to incorporate the journaling aspect of what I was doing anyway, because I used to keep journals anyway, and I write in my journals, but I dabbled in keeping sketchbooks, but I never really quite got the idea of what the sketchbook was supposed to do for me. And so it was after doing a couple of courses. I did, I think it was Kelly Ray Roberts' course. I did Jenny Doe's course. So many, many years ago. And I started drawing in what I call my journal. Mm-hmm. And it was very difficult initially for me to get the hang of, because I was thinking to myself, well, I want to draw, but I also want to write more than the page would allow me to write. Mm-hmm. And it was, I think I was thinking that way because I started putting restrictions on myself even then. It was just like, unless you're going to write reams and reams of pages, then it's not really a journal. And mm-hmm. you're not really an art journalist because, you know, you don't know how to do it like they do it. Mm-hmm. But as I went on, I realized that I make my own rules. It can be what I want it to be.
Yes.
And I just started to relax in that, and I would allow my pages to express what I was feeling, mm-hmm. and not what I thought it should look like. Right. And so I just thought, you know, some days I would draw an image, and some days I would write something, some days I would write a word. And then the other person that really kind of inspired me at the time was Tam, and she does a willowing course. And so I did her free course, and it was just like, oh, there's, you know, I can just use words to express, a word to express. Mm-hmm. And then as I went on, I saw more and more artists using journals in the way that I actually really wanted to use it. And that was to incorporate mixed media, to kind of play, to practice. And so from then, I've just kind of, I've got sort of like, I don't know, a few hundred journals that I've been working on. And then the other thing was, the other restriction I put on myself was that I had to finish one journal before moving on to the next. Mm. So it had to be complete. Mm. And it was just like, but that's not the way you work. And so again, I had to give myself permission and to work the way that I wanted to work. And so the art journal, my art journal journey then became, how do I want to express myself? How do I want to even experiment with materials or ideas? And so that's what my journey, you know, that's how I started anyway, you know, just dipping my feet in and then finding ways to make it work for me.
Yeah. No, I love that. I love hearing the, I put restrictions on myself. Then I realized, no, that's not how you work. So take the restrictions off and be free and allow yourself to make your own rules. I think that phrase is so important, especially if you're new and you're starting out. Make your own rules. It's okay. There is no standard for art journaling and what it has to be and should be. So thank you for saying that, because I think so many people, when they start, when they find this world of art journaling, there's so much and there's so many different people doing it in different styles that they feel like it has to look like what they see out in the world. Yeah, and I would say that your art definitely does have its own style and its own flair, and I think that's what I love most about it, is that it's not trying to fit into any of these other spaces that already exist. So I love that.
Mm-hmm. The other thing people, who are just venturing on art journaling is that they see somebody's work who might have been doing it for, like, say, 10 years. So they come in the middle of somebody's journey and they think, oh, it has to look like that, rather than seeing. I mean, I'll show you later some of my early stuff. And it's just like, you know, it's a progression. It's a process. So you've got to allow yourself to go on that journey.
Yes, that is so important. I think that phrase of don't compare your beginning to somebody else's middle. Like that idea is so powerful in art, in writing, in any creative endeavor, even in life, right? I mean, we're looking at people who are 60 years old thinking, oh man, I want to have the same house and car and bank account they have, and that it doesn't work that way, right? There's a progression in all things. So yeah, thank you for saying that. I think we're probably going to have, this is a little bit off topic, but not really. I think we're going to have people who are curious like me. And I feel like I already know this because, you know, we've been working together for a year pretty much here with the Journey Within. So why don't you take a few minutes to tell people where you are and where you come from, and maybe a little bit about your background, because I know they're curious right now, like, what is that accent? Where is she? Where is she? What is that? Because I know the first time I heard you in a video, I was like, oh my God, that's even more awesome. So why don't you share with folks where you are, where you're from, so they can, they too can be amazed in where the accent comes from.
Okay, so I was born in London, England, and lived there for many, many years. And last year, so 2015, my husband is from Barbados. So my parents are from Jamaica. Mm-hmm. And so my husband was born in Barbados and also lived in England. He moved to England when he was really young, a teenager. And so it's always been his dream to live in Barbados. And so after coming here for many years on holiday, my son also decided he wanted to study here. We had a tour of the university, and I guess I kind of caught up with them in the sense of wanting to be somewhere different. So we moved to Barbados last year, and it's been a very interesting journey. It's not been easy. It's been I've had to take a step of faith, and I've had to just we adapt. I think it's that restriction, and when I just sort of like said, it's an adventure. Okay, let's go.
Yeah.
We've been here a year now, just over a year. Yeah. And it's been very interesting. And I would recommend, if anybody can do it, to do it. Yeah. You know, because you never know. It was about, I've never lived anywhere else.
Mm.
And what also interested me was this, actually that journey. So when I think of my mother, who traveled to England from Jamaica in the 60s,
wow,
and then lived there, settled there, family, three children. Mm. And then I never ever imagined I would live anywhere else but England. You have kind of, I'd like to go to America or wherever it is. But then my journey back to the Caribbean, and also my son's journey, he's 20, and what that actually means, in terms of the world is such a smaller place now, and the way that we communicate is just so much easier now. And even in that, when my mother came to England, we would have to wait, say, 3 weeks for communication from Jamaica, so from my grandmother. But now we can just, we're talking both in real time, and that accessibility just really cool. But the move to Barbados has just kind of opened up so many other things that I want to do, so many other areas of work that I'm experimenting with, and just connecting with that story and the journey that we make, and that inner journey that we make and that we're continuing to make. So it's been a really, it's fulfilling, I guess, fulfilling.
Yeah. No, thank you for that, because I love how you can take your mother's journey and look at your own journey and the parallels between the two. I think that's very powerful, even with, children, right? Having children and what that looks like. And I think the words you use was your story. And I think so often we forget, not only as artists, but as women, that while there are other people around us that we nurture and we care for, we actually do have our very own unique individual story. And I think sometimes we forget that. And so, yeah, thank you for saying that, because that's really important. And I love that you said you caught up with them, because I know so many times, sometimes the idea of an adventure is like, oh, that's awesome. But sometimes we have to catch up to the idea. So, yeah, I love that honesty around that. Tell us a little bit about what your creative practice looks like. Like, what is your, are you a full-time artist? Is that what you do all the time? And what does that look like for you?
Yeah. Well, it took me a long time to accept the fact that I was an artist. I've been creative for about 25 years now. And it's only been 9 years that I became a full-time artist. And but that also incorporates other things that I do alongside that. So I work I've been working in terms of dementia and arts in health alongside that. Mm-hmm. And then just doing not just painting and creating, but a whole range of other things, like, I'm on social media, I teaching online, and I don't think I'll ever just paint. I enjoy doing lots and lots of things. Mm-hmm. And that's the thing that excites me, that because I'm impatient as well. In some respects, I'm impatient as well. But and so that's why I kind of incorporate a lot of other things in my work. But mm-hmm. I think essentially 60% is my creative practice. Is I spend time in the studio, I'm painting, I'm making something. Mm. And using, in terms of mixed media, using a wide range of materials. So one day I could be painting, one day I could be, you know, sculpting, one day I could be using the sewing machine and creating mini quilts and things like that. So, and then I would say 30% of the rest of the time is spent on social media, you know, the whole range, and creating videos and editing videos and things like that. And I think I'll probably spend a lot more time making videos than the editing, so I'm trying to catch up with that as well. And then the other percent of the time is, you know, obviously life, you know, and the percentages are probably not as clear cut as that, because, you know, you've got a family, you've got to, you know, I've got my mum still in England and, you know, stuff I'm trying to do there. So I don't spend all my time painting, which I'd love to do. But again, that's the thing, that it's not a realistic thing unless you are, you know, you've got patrons that support you, or, you know, angels who, you know, you have to kind of get on with the rest of life and try and, you know, I think my main passion is to be able to be a blessing. So whatever I'm doing, to be able to inspire and encourage somebody else. So if it is something that I'm making that inspires, or if it's a photograph that I've taken that, you know, that can encourage somebody with a quote or a scripture, you know, that's I think my whole life is about creating, making, inspiring, encouraging. Because I've been inspired by so many other artists and encouraged by them. So
yeah.
I think that's probably what it looks like. But it's a mixture of you know, just trying to make ends meet, pay your bills, you know, create something, do something with it. You know, it's sometimes a paint, you know, painting isn't just the painting. It could be a print. It could be a, you know, part of a course. It could be part of a, you know, merchandise, but not merchandise, you know, you could license it or whatever it is you want to do with it.
Right.
But yeah, just trying to cover all the bases and see how, in one sense, see how broad it can be, but in another sense, I know that I've got to be focused.
Right.
So that's the other thing.
Yeah.
So
in listening to that, I heard you say, you know, but life takes over, right? You still have to eat and pay the bills and cook and right. And I love that because it ties so nicely into the name of your blog, like Reality Arts. Like there's a reality part that goes with that, right? And I love how you're like just reinforcing that. Like you can be a full-time artist, but it doesn't mean your life stops. It doesn't mean that your kids don't still need you and your partner or husband doesn't still need you. And right. So, and that you don't have your own personal things you have to deal with every day. So I love that you are highlighting that, because I think it's important. I think people feel like they either have to just do art or they have to live a life. Like they can't figure out how to balance the two. And so I love that you're sharing that. I would love for you to talk a little bit about, my father lived with Alzheimer's for 10 years, maybe a couple years more, maybe 10 to 11. And so I am very, very intimately aware and connected to the idea of dementia. I know what it does to not only the person, but the family and the people, their loved ones, the people around them. It is a very impactful, I don't know if they call it a disease or not, situation, right? It impacts more than just the person that has it. And so I'd love for you to talk a little bit about the work you do with dementia patients and people who have who are in that situation in terms of art therapy and how you help them.
Yeah, well, dementia is a disease. It's a term for a collection of diseases that affect the brain. So my mother suffers or is living with mm-hmm. because living with Alzheimer's. Mm-hmm. And I looked after her for about 17 years. Mm-hmm. Amongst three siblings, so my older sister and my younger brother, I was the one in terms of, you know, okay, you're an artist, okay, so you have a bit more time. My time was more flexible. Right. And so they helped where they could. You know, my sister's a teacher, my brother worked in IT. So, I kind of looked after her. Now she's in the latter stages, as they would call it, the severe stages, where she's unable to do anything for herself. There is some communication. She can respond. And I would say the way I look at it is that the brain, there are parts of the brain that are damaged. Mm-hmm. And then the parts that we communicate with are the ones that they're going to have more difficulty with. So like we just talked about, you know, that there may be a lag. I think that, and I feel in terms of communication, that she hasn't yet caught up with what I told her, say, a few hours ago. And so when I'm speaking about something else, she might just be answering or responding to aspects of it or trying to find the words. Because a lot of people think that if you've got dementia, we'll just call it dementia because that then encompasses all of the diseases. Right. If you've got dementia, then there's nothing there, that you're an empty space, that, you know, and you hear these terms and it's just like, that's not the case. Mm-hmm. And so, and people find it very difficult to know how to then relate to somebody with dementia. And so I started off initially looking after my mum, and then I got involved in talking about the role of a carer to social workers who were in the beginning of their training. So there was an organisation called the Tavistock, which they would go and do their training. And they so I started doing talks there to the first year, second year students. And it would be about, how do you relate to a carer who is looking after somebody living with Alzheimer's? And it's just like, because you go through so many different emotions, you know, the guilt, the frustration, the anger, the fear. And that's on both sides. And I would say to them, if you think about yourself and the time that you felt most afraid, mm-hmm. how did you deal with that? You know, you felt angry, you didn't know what to do. And I say to them, you know, well, relate to somebody who's living with Alzheimer's and doesn't know what's happening, doesn't know why they can't remember or why they can't find the words. And we've all been at that point where the word is on the tip of our tongue, and it's just like, I just can't remember what it is. And maybe, you know, you then remember afterwards. So that then led on to talking to groups of social workers who were at the more senior stage. So they were able to then, if they decided you had a problem, they didn't have to wait for a doctor to co-sign the form that they would then section you.
Right.
So I was speaking to those social workers, and then that led on to doing conferences and talking at Arts and Health, Creative Arts Dementia is an organisation that I'm also connected with, and then London Arts and Health Forum. Mm. And so I was kind of beginning to talk about what I was doing, my role as a carer, but then as an artist, I found that it was just engaging with my mum. It was just like, she'd come round to my house and it was, mum, do you want to do some drawing? And I was shocked for her to say, hey, okay, what do you want me to draw? And it was just like, before dementia, she was never interested in doing anything creative.
Right.
So I'd like, you know, hand her, just get magazine photos and things like that, and she would draw and stuff. And it was just like, okay, you know, this has kept her engaged for like an hour and a half, 2 hours. Mm-hmm. And then I came into the daycare centre that she would go to. She would go to it for 4 days a week. And then I said to them, you know, do you want me to run some art workshops? And I'd never run any art workshops. I'd only done it with my mum. But it was just like they were open. And yeah. That led to a 4-year kind of relationship where I was coming in. And I was able to then kind of work out how they should be. I kind of incorporated music from the era, a relaxed kind of environment where they could talk. And just kind of get them interested in it. They didn't even have to do any drawing or painting. It was just like just sitting amongst, because I do displays of the work, and just sitting in what was almost like a mini gallery, just seeing other people create, that had a therapeutic effect on them as well. And because we know what it's like when we go to an art gallery, how we feel, you know, how that can, you could sit there for hours and look at a painting. And so I realized that allowing them to just relax, using creativity, using the reminiscence aspect, getting them to talk about, because the long-term memory is a thing that kind of stays around for longer. And so they can recall, you know, what they did as children, or when they, you know, played in the yard, or, you know, went to school, or had to walk, you know, 6 miles or whatever to get to school. So they could recall all of that. And it was just like, okay, so now how can we use art in a therapeutic setting? Because I'm not an art therapist. They have their own, but I use art in a therapeutic way. And I think we've, there are many instances, especially in the UK and especially in the States, that I've come across, that art is used in that therapeutic way. And so museum visits, getting theatre groups to come in, getting singers, you know, using dance, because that's also another thing, and kind of trying to tap into all the different, you know, areas. We find music is also a really great tool that we can use. And so again, that's what I've been doing. And so since coming to Barbados, I connected with the Barbados Alzheimer's Association. Arts and health isn't something that's here at the moment. And so just trying to see how I can engage and connect with other artists here, and just show what I'm doing, and show how, you know, you can use art and creative activities. Because right now, at the moment, focused on, well, what is dementia? How is it affecting us? I mean, there's 4,000 people here so far that have been diagnosed. I mean, the figure is growing. And so people are just, what do we do? How do we cope? And so where I'm not able to focus a lot on how art and creative activities can impact, I'm kind of trying to develop workshops and programs that are, okay, this is what dementia is. This is how, you know, we know that there's no cure. So, okay, so here's what we can put in place. And so slowly bringing in the art and creativity activities. So, in the last month, I've been talking a lot about, you know, the last year, for the association, just, you know, sharing what I do, sharing what I did, sharing, because I've been from the very beginning, the early stages, the middle stages, the end stages, the putting in a home stages, the what do I do as a carer, the feeling that I, you know, sometimes I feel the guilt of, it feels like I've abandoned mum, you know, and but these are feelings that people go through, and we have to talk about them. Some people don't want to be, you know, some people might not want to be a carer, you know, there is a choice, you know, being a carer is different from caring for someone. You know, there's a different level of intensity. And not everybody's up to it. Not everybody who works in the field actually cares. You know, they work in the caring field, but they don't really actually care for people. Right. You know, we know how we feel in terms of relating. And so, it's been another journey where something that I never thought I would get involved in. I just wanted to be an artist. I never thought that I would be working with art and health. I never thought I would be marrying the two, but it's actually really fulfilling, because creativity, I think, is at the heart of all of us. And I think we all, not just, you know, if you're caring for somebody or if you've got some illness, because, you know, it's used in terms of cancer patients, stroke patients, but I think we should all be doing some sort of creative activity. So that's what I'm kind of advocating.
That is so important. I mean, everything you're saying there, just from, because I watched my mother care for my father pretty much the last 10 years of his life, and they weren't even married anymore. But she took care of him and, you know, made sure that he had everything he needed, up until the point where we literally had to take him from her. Like, we were like, Ma, it's time. He needs more than you can actually give him in a day. You know, he wasn't speaking anymore. He wasn't eating on his own. I mean, it just got to the point where we could not allow her to keep she was driving herself into the ground. She wouldn't let anybody else take care of him. And there's a whole mentality that goes along with that, and understanding how to work with folks who are caretakers of people who have dementia. So I applaud you for the work that you're doing in that field, because I know everything from the people in the centers who are trained to do that kind of work, to take care of people, all the way to the people who are just family members who decided that they're going to take on that task of taking care of the person. Like, there's a whole, the spectrum of that is very, it's important that people know how to do that, and that they have an outlet for what to do in their downtime. And then I love that you also decided that you work with the people who have dementia. So, you know, both of those are, that's important work. And I love that you put a creative spin on it, and that you found a way to tie it to your creativity. So, like I said, yeah, I'm just, thank you for being somebody who's taken that on in the world. So that's a big deal. It's a really big deal. I'd love to hear you talk a little bit about one of the things that I really, I feel like connects to that in a different way, but I think it just goes to your, who you are as an artist and your heart, and going back to what you said about you just want to inspire people and you want to help, you know, be a blessing to people. So one really big part of the work that you do is about helping people quiet their inner critic and move past the block of the inner critic telling them that it's not good enough or they can't do it. So I'd love for you to talk a little bit about why that shows up so much in the teachings that you do, because it's actually really, really powerful. Like, it's one thing to say, oh, I'm not going to listen to my inner critic. It's another thing to actually go through activities and exercises the way you do to help people actually move past that. So talk a little bit about that and how it shows up in your work and in your creative process.
I guess it shows up a lot because that critic is always with us. I don't think we can ever get rid of it. And I've kind of, over the years, struggled with whether I was an artist, whether I should call myself an artist, whether I should, whether I could sell my work, whether I had any value in selling my work, whether somebody would pay, you know, what I put a value on it. And ultimately I went through, I would create pieces and somebody would say, oh, how much is it? And I'd just give it away. You know, it'd be like, oh no, you know, you take it, you know, this is, and again, because I started off as a, I guess it started from very early on, because I wanted to do art from forever. So from when I was in my secondary school. So as a teenager, I wanted to be an artist. But there was one teacher I remember who encouraged me, and it was just like that opened me up. But the teacher that was involved with careers advice just said, you know, well, don't go and, I wanted to do A-level art, you know, I wanted to go on and study. And she was just like, oh, no, just leave and get a job. And I was crushed. And so I went, and the other thing was, you know, art in those days wasn't seen as something you could earn money from. So the choices that I was given was work in the bank, become a teacher, become a nurse, or become a secretary. And it was just like, but I want to be creative. And it was just like, so I went into that very early on, and it was just like, you know, it took me years and years to just even start drawing again. And so I started drawing again, but I was always, you know, it's, you're not good enough. You didn't do a degree course, you know? And so I was a self-taught, you know, from, you know, my early 20s, I then just started to practice and just do as much as I could. And that self-critic was always there. And even so, even when I set up things like my website, I looked back a few years and I realized that I was putting stuff up, but I wasn't allowing anybody to buy anything, because again, I didn't put any value in it. And it was just like, nobody would want to buy it. You know, I'm just showing you what I'm doing. But it's taken years for me to, since I worked in the corporate field, I worked in education, I worked in health, And then it wasn't until I was made redundant and I had this feeling of, you know, even the corporate world doesn't want you, you know, they're making you redundant. And so it was just like, but no, but see it as you've got an opportunity now to engage in art. You know, you've got enough money to keep you going to, you know, and I was buying materials alongside, you know, working and trying to find time and complaining I didn't have time. But again, it was just like, well, you know, if you were a proper artist, you'd be able to find the time. Mm. And so when I allowed myself to write, okay, I'm an artist. And then I would say, but then people would say, well, what kind of art do you do? You know, and it was just like, I now have to then explain to you, you know, you don't just accept, if I tell you I'm a teacher, if I tell you I'm a doctor, you don't say, well, what, you know, generally speaking, you just accept that label.
Right.
And so it was just like, I realized that I had to learn how to make friends with the critic, because the critic was always going to be there. And if I saw my critic as the voice that was trying to protect me in a weird, warped sense, that when, you know, and the critic didn't want me to be embarrassed or didn't want me to, you know, fall flat on my face. So rather than approaching me in a kind way, the critic would always be kind of this rough kind of, you know, say it as they see it kind of person.
Right.
And so what I realized, and in terms of the courses, was that you had to learn how to trick the critic. You had to learn how to make her, I mean, she's a her for me, might be a her for a him for somebody else, but I had to find a way to make her feel that she wasn't being threatened. Mm-hmm. So if I produced a piece of work, you know, it wasn't a threatening environment, so that she had to kind of rear her head and say, you know, but she's always there. She's always there muttering. She's always there. But you have to have, it's about having the confidence and the courage to just kind of step out. Well, I'm going to do it anyway. Yeah. And one of the other courses that I took was, I think it was through Brave Girls, you know, and it was soul restoration. It was just like, okay, how can you provide the environment, you know, that I can thrive in, you know. So it's not everybody that I allow to come into my home. It's not everybody that I allow to come to the gate. Like the postman only comes to the outside of the gate and he, you know, in the post box, but nobody else uses that post box. Nobody else puts anything in there. So I had to kind of be aware of the kind of people that I had allowing in. It's not everybody that you show your work to.
Yeah.
So if you're in a supportive environment, that's fine. But if you're in an environment that people say, my gosh, you couldn't even color inside the lines, you know, and that's what a lot of young people kind of, you know, like children they grow up in. But I thought I told you to draw inside the lines, you know, to color inside the lines. What's that? And it's just like, but, you know, and so we've got to find ways to, because I also believe that as well as the critic, we've got that inner child that still needs to be nurtured. You know, I may be an adult, but there's parts of me that, you know, can sometimes act like a child. Like, for instance, like we went to the beach and whenever it's hurricane season, it's just like between, I think it's June and December or November. The weathers can be quite, you know, rough, and the seas can be quite rough. So whenever a big wave comes, I'm screaming. I'm going, ah! And my son was just like, why are you screaming? You're the only one that's screaming. And it's just like, but I'm having fun. You know, I'm screaming, but I'm having fun. So there's the inner child that still needs to be nurtured. And some of the exercises that I find works is ones where we're just reminding ourselves who we are. We're answering those questions that are difficult, but we're also celebrating our successes, even no matter how small, because a lot of us have grown up with not having somebody affirm our gifts and our qualities and the things that they love about us and the joy that they get from us. And I think we have to, in celebrating those things, we kind of comfort the child within us. And it helps us to grow, and then we can do more things, and then we step out, and we can also you know, quieten the inner critic who, you know, just wants to make sure everything is all right. So if you see it as not my arched enemy, but somebody that's trying to work alongside, but it's too brash, right. You know. And so I've been finding even for myself, so there are times where I feel really up, really good, really, yeah, I can create all of these things. And then sometimes I don't want to be in my creative space and I don't want to even look at a pencil. And so I'm finding that when I start answering those questions or giving myself an encouraging word, it might just be that I do a doodle and that then kind of gets me back into that space. Yeah. But I think it's a constant, you know, a constant struggle or a constant dance. So it's a constant dance because you hear of people that are accomplished artists who say they still have their off days. And so I don't think that we can say as artists, you know, where we are, that we should not have any problems. There should be, you know, there should be, I'm not going to hear these voices that say you can't. Yeah. But I say to myself, like, when I see someone, can I say, oh, I can do that, you know, or somebody says to me, you know, that's why, you know, why I've been able to, you know, some of the talks that I've done, somebody will say, oh, you know, do you think you could do a talk on, we're doing it, like, my first talk was with, at a conference, and there was 26 people that we broke away and I had to do this workshop. And I was just like, yeah, of course I can do that. And it's just like, okay, so... Right, okay, so we're an hour and a half. And so other opportunities open up. And if you just say, yeah, I can do that, and along the way you can find out how to do it. You know, there's nothing that you can't do. I'm not going to fly to the moon, but I know that, you know, if somebody asked me to do something creative, you know, I can do that. So, you know, and you give yourself the opportunity and see it as an adventure. And that's where I say that, you know, with my inner child and with my critic, we're going on this adventure and we're going to do it and we're going to find ways to do it. And between us, we're going to, you know, find all the different exciting things that we can do. You know, sometimes, you know, sometimes I am quiet, you know, I can be shy, but there's a part of me that's the extrovert that, you know, yes, yeah, I want to do this. But I think as well, because some of the art, because it's coming from me and because it's expressing how you feel, you can feel a bit kind of insecure about sharing it and showing it. Yeah. And I think that differentiation between, for me, there isn't very much of a differentiation between, well, this is what I'm doing to express myself and this is my art. Mm-hmm. Because in my art is a part of me. And I express my feelings and my thoughts through it. So I've got a piece where I show a sculpture that I've been working on that I show the inner critic, which seems really strong, but she's blinded. And then you've got me who's feeling kind of insecure, and then you've got the inner child, you know. So a lot of my work also expresses parts of me. And so I think if you can accept that your art can sometimes tell your own story, mm-hmm. and just know that if you tell your story, somebody else will be inspired to tell theirs.
Yes.
And so, that's why the inner critic comes up a lot, because I know that we're all dealing with it.
Yes.
And we're all finding ways, you know.
Exactly. Yeah. I love that you are expressing it from the standpoint of your inner child, you, and then the inner critic, and that those three just need to kind of be in harmony with each other, work together, understand one another. Going back to something you said earlier, that the inner critic is really trying to protect you in its own weird sort of way, but that's really what it's there for. And I firmly believe that it really is. It's our protective mechanism. It's the way that we keep ourselves from, or that we try, we think we can keep ourselves from experiencing shame or embarrassment or having to deal with failure, that kind of thing. So I love that spin on it. And I have to say, the classes that you have taught for us in the Journey Within, the students, like, they always come, you know, come to the Google Plus community and say, oh my God, I just finished Amanda's lesson and here's what happened and here's what showed up for me. So I think it's important because I think you're going to have, the inner critic is going to be there at every stage of your creative journey. And it's just learning how to embrace that inner critic and knowing how to walk alongside it and understand why it's there. It serves a purpose. And so I love that. And then the reconnecting with your inner child, so important as a creative person, no matter what kind of creative, you know, endeavor you take on, there's always that inner child that at some point was either shut down or told they couldn't do it or not allowed to do it or used to be free, but the adult in you has quieted that part. I love that you speak about the inner child, because I think that's important to allow the inner child to have some space in your creative practice. So, yeah. Let's talk a little bit. Tell me a little bit about what other kinds of art you do. You've mentioned several times that, you know, you've done other things. So what other kind, besides painting and art journaling, what else do you do?
So I sculpt, and I work with fabric. I wanted to start, again, it's with this telling a story. So I wanted to learn how to quilt, and I didn't really want to make these big quilts. And I realized that, why don't I just do my art and use quilting techniques? So I use quilting, because what happened very early on was that I hadn't realized what kind of artist I wanted to be. I didn't know anything about mixed media. So I thought I wanted to draw, and then I started painting, and then I wanted to do oils, and then I wanted to be a jewelry designer. And there was just all these things, and I was buying all these tools, and then came across mixed media. I think it was on YouTube. And it was just like, oh my gosh, that's what I want to do. That's how I want to express myself. And so it was just like, I've got all these materials. I don't want to, a scrapbooking was one, but I never managed to finish a scrapbook, but collected again all the stuff. And so it was just like bringing everything together and utilizing it. So I've done a book journaling course and started making books, started altering books, started making what I call art and healing journals. And that would just be, you know, something that nobody would get to see. This would just be whatever I'm thinking at that particular time, however I'm feeling. And then I wanted to make books from fabric, and then embroidery. So I collected lots of beads and lots of buttons and things like that, and so sculpture now is quite a large part, because I'm producing some pieces for an exhibition, so I've started experimenting in that sense. The other thing I do is using recycled material, so making things with recycled material. So I came across a guy on YouTube who made a bookcase, and it was just like, I can do that. And so I made the bookcase, made another one in process, but then started making other things. It was just like, being in Barbados, there was some of the furniture here is quite expensive, but also some of the, if I wanted stuff for the studio, it was just like, am I going to have to order it online? It was just like, no, I can make that. Yeah. So I started making lots of the things that I'd seen, like in stores, that I thought, yeah, I want one of those, or, you know, to house my, like, I've got loads of Pro Marker pens and things like that. So I was like, okay, I'll house those there, and just like little boxes. And I just love making. So I was just, I've allowed myself the freedom to experiment. And so I also don't kind of restrict myself. Like, you know, there are things that I want to try and make, but I don't want to include in my as something that Amanda, the artist, is making. So, you know, the recycled furniture stuff is just something I would do to play around in my studio and create things for my studio. But again, you know, the clay stuff was, again, I came across Miss Stell, and she made this clay doll, and it was just like, oh my gosh, I really want to do clay. And so I started, you know, working with her, and then Tiara, and it was just like, there was just so many there's so much food coming from other artists that I was just like, okay, clay is something that I was so glad I came across that. Yeah. And so I just kind of, you know, look and see what other people are doing and look and see whether I want to make it just because I want to make something or whether I want to actually really, you know, incorporate some of the techniques into my work as an artist.
Right. So why don't we have a look at some of your art? I'm going to put you big on the screen. If you want to show us some paintings or art journaling, whatever you want to show us, we'd love to see some of your work.
Okay. I want to show you the one that I did with the critic. I'll just get it.
Okay.
But you can see some of the art below, behind me, but some of the art I do kind of developed out of my art journal. So I'll show you an art journal, like my very first art journal. And like, this was my first ever painted drawings.
Nice.
And it was just like, it felt odd because I used to draw, and I'll show you some of my drawings. So I was doing kind of, drawings like that. And then paintings, I was, you know, commissioned. This is my old boss. I was commissioned to do some pieces. Wow. And so when I started doing these journals, it was just like, you can't draw. My critic was just like, you can't draw. You know, what do you think you're doing? And so, but I just, you know, kept on. And I used this as a way of kind of working through, inspiration for myself.
Yeah.
And then I kind of started making my own journal. I didn't make this journal. This is a book, but I covered it. It was just like, okay, so I can, you know, do my own thing. And again, started to use it. So it's supposed to show me and I'm being rescued. So again, using it and writing in it, but kind of being a bit more expressive. So I started, you know, creating larger pieces,
mm-hmm.
And again, just playing. So I just played and played with materials, and again, this one isn't finished. I wanted to start a story, so I started a story, and this was like a group of 10 pictures that I then wanted to create into a painting series, but I haven't yet done that yet. So it's got ideas, but it's not yet finished.
Right.
But let's see, what else? I'll show you this one. So this is a journal that I just kind of created, started doing complete paintings. And so this was just like, okay, so it's not just me writing on it. This is something that if I was doing it on canvas, so then I had to kind of maybe think about, well, do you need to start, I do most of my paintings in books, so do you need to start actually working on the canvases that you've got sitting there, and, you know, and rather than, and doing larger pieces of work, because, like, you know, this one, it was just like, I'd done a painting of the desert, but then I wanted to change it, and because I'm incorporating more figures into my work, it was just like, you can see maybe the pencil, the graphite marks, but it was just like, this is too big. I was overwhelmed. I was kind of, and it's just like, you need to just get over it, just get over it. And like this particular book, this is a good book because all it is, it's a John Lewis catalog.
Oh, wow.
But what I do is I gesso it, like, some of the furniture here. So this was in the picture, this was in the picture. And what I do is gesso it and then add images. And it was just like, when you're feeling like you can't do anything creative, mm-hmm. just do something. You don't even have to, you know, you don't even have to think about what you're drawing. You just need to gesso out, you know, images. Like this was lampshades.
Uh-huh.
So this was lampshades in the picture, and all I did was gesso the rest of it out, put a bird and make it as if it's like cages, you know. So it was just like again wanting to create images from my imagination,
right,
you know, make up scenes in the background and do beautiful backgrounds. So I also started to again work bigger, but work I'll show you just again work with, you know, different ideas. So a lot of my paintings now, so this one isn't finished, mm-hmm. but this one was inspired, you know, being in Barbados, you're seeing loads of sunsets, you know, you're seeing the sea, and they're really inspiring, and families now as well, you know, groups of families. So this particular image was from a magazine, but then I thought I wanted to create figures behind her. And again, this is an unfinished one. You know, I had to also be patient, because the way I worked sometimes was it had to be finished there and then. And so I had to learn how to walk away from a painting and create, walk away. So when I started doing the fabric type of work, so I started with, this is fabric paper. So I learned this technique from Mika from Motley Soul. So you sandwich fabric in between, you put paper in between fabric, and it's like, you know, really pliable. And so I, you know, did some stitching and embroidery there, and you could paint. But again, wanted to take painting on fabric further. So I started, these are some of my pieces where I, you know, paint an image and then I use the beads and, you know, lots of different things to incorporate into it. And this is a really therapeutic activity, because, you know, you can't finish it in one go. You're going to have to come back. So I would lay down the background colors, then I would find the image, and then I'd take it to the sewing machine and, you know, sew around the images. And then the final bit would be to add the beads, and just kind of picking out the beads. And like, I then started scouring charity shops, because my local one it was an Oxfam charity shop, and they would do bags of jewelry and beads. And so I was like, I almost got quite addictive to going in there and finding out whether there was a big bag. And then what I do is, because it was quite close to where my mum lived, I'd sit at the table and I'd open it all out, and then I'd just kind of just enjoy going through some of the things that I would find in there. And some of them were like, you know, you'd find jewelry, silver jewelry, mm-hmm. and things that people just thought, you know, they were clearing out a drawer and just put everything together. So the other things, I'll show you some of my the cardboard made stuff. So this was, I saw one of those old time drawers, and so I thought, gosh, I could do that in cardboard. So I had to work out how everything fit together, and so you know, just recycling, because whilst they do recycle, they don't kind of make very much here from recycled stuff. And then I started, so this is supposed to be, I was going to do a chattel house, So chattel houses are, you know, all around the island and stuff. But I wanted to make it into something that was going to be functional. Mm-hmm. And so I found we have these bottles like this. So there's a lot of these bottles that, you know, you normally have coconut water and things like that. Uh-huh. So you could get through a lot of that. And so I thought, I want to make it so that somebody can put a plant in it. But also use it as a, you know, like when I'm using it in terms of the elderly and memory and reminiscence. Yes. Once this is finished, it will look like a chattel house. This bit will look like a chattel house, uh-huh. and obviously the bits underneath. But it can be functional, so you can have like a little cactus or something growing in it. Uh-huh. So it's like, okay, how can we, how can I play about with ideas? And so some of the sculptures... I did this, so they started out again, you know, how can I find use materials so the inside of this is made from recycled material, and then it's covered in clay, and then it's covered in this particular material that makes the fabric really hard, and then it's, you know, lost and stuff. And so I do that with canvases as well. So I made my own canvas. So this is just made out of cardboard, and then it's covered with it's the fabric clay. It's not fabric clay, but it's the, they use for bandages.
Yeah.
And then, you know, molded faces, and then again just I make my own clay, so from tissue. I'm trying to find a way of making my own clay from, like, you know, recycled paper. Right. But at the moment, it's tissue. But I need a really high-speed blender.
Right. Yes.
But just allowing myself to experiment, and just if I want to make something, make it, you know. And how can I utilize the recycled material? But I wanted to show you, this is the critic one that I'm working on.
Wow.
So this is the critic, this is the inner child. The critic's eyes are covered and her mouth is covered, because the critic doesn't always see what is the truth. It just reacts and says what's on her mind, and so I can't always see what the critic is seeing, and I can't always listen to what the critic is saying. Mm-hmm. But the inner child, yeah, is there surrounded by the critic, because, mm-hmm. you know, I grew up, my early childhood grew up and was bullied at a primary school. So I grew up trying to make myself feel small, insignificant, and disappear. Mm-hmm. And that's the me side where, you know, I need to embrace who I am, because we're all so unique. We all have that gift inside us, but all royalty, you know. Yeah. We all got that presence that can change lives, that can impact on lives. And but it's how we live, you know. Sometimes it's more that gets the voice, and then sometimes it's like, you know, okay, I can't be angry with the critic. I can't be angry with the child who is feeling insecure, but I have to be gentle, mm-hmm. and I have to come with grace. So yeah, the clay, and, you know, has allowed me to kind of just expand and grow and step out and even coming over here, because again, you know, the first one in my family to, apart from my mum, of course, you know, in terms of siblings, you know,
yeah.
to kind of venture across the waters and just, I want to, you know, just do more and be more and, you know, be able to, you know, when you take that last breath, say, you know, I really lived life. I really enjoyed my life. I really gave as much as I could give. And, you know, I don't want to be able to, oh, I wish I did some kite surfing. I wish. I say kite surfing because I thought I really wanted to kite surf because what I saw and what I thought somebody was doing. And then when I came to Barbados and I was saying to this friend of ours, you know, I really want to kite surf. And he was just like, well, I've got a kite surf. And then when he told me, it was just this massive big kite and a massive big surfboard out in the middle of the... And I was just like, no, that's not what I want to do. So, but yeah, just to try everything and to be adventurous.
Yeah, I love that. Well, while we have you big in the screen, first of all, let me say this. Those sculptures just blew my mind. I can't even tell you, like, I feel a little bit like off my game now that I've seen them because they're so, I was not expecting that. Like, I don't know what I was expecting. I think sculpture, I guess I was thinking pottery in my mind, but you've sculpted these people that are, oh my God, I need to, I'm going to have to find, I don't know if you have pictures of them somewhere that we can share. I can share links out to people because they are, wow, amazing. I'm like totally taken aback by them. They are gorgeous. So I love to see more of them for sure because I think I just had in my mind, I think sculpture, I think it's going to be a vase or it's going to be, you know, so I love, love, love. And the one with the inner critic and the child, and then you turn it around and it's a representative of you on one side. That is powerful because when you turn it around, now they're on your backside and it's like the many, many ways to interpret that, right? You can interpret that as that's behind me. You can interpret it as that they've got my back. I mean, there's so many ways you can interpret that and the power in that. So, wow, that just made my day. I can't even tell you. That was awesome to see that. So while we have you in the big screen, why don't we have you share some of your favorite art supplies with us?
Okay. I guess the most favorite one is that we all use gesso.
Yes.
When I found gesso and the fact that the one that I buy, it's not this particular one. It was one that I got in England, but it's a quite thick. It's a thicker one. Mm-hmm. So you can, when you work with stencils, you can create, you know, texture through the stencils. So I really like that. Stencils. I'll just show you two, but I love stencils. So I've got a whole, I collect loads of stencils.
Yes. Yes.
And the other thing I do is, you know, finding, again, recycled material. So, but finding ways in which you can find other things that you can use as a stencil. Like, you know, I found this and it was, I think people do embroidery through it and things like these things, but they're like for the inside of the sink. And they're sort of, yeah, the wash, the, you know, the stop the dishes from, but spraying through them. It's like when I found this and when you compare something like this to say a stencil like that, I mean, this is a fraction of the cost. This cost me like $5 today, but this was in store. This is like, I mean, I got this in the UK, but over here, this was like $40. And it was just like, okay, so what can I find again, looking at other materials that you can find to utilize? And then, you know, you can find a whole different array of, you know, these are just mats that go in that you can utilize. So stencils are a big one. Brushes. Mm-hmm. I love brushes. I love brushes. And this is just a small selection. But what I find with brushes is that I would have a favorite one and then I kind of work it to death. You know, I mean, I brought a lot of these things when I was working full time and, you know, was then kind of building up my supply. I love Pro Marker pens. And I guess I'm also, I don't know what the word is, My husband will probably call it a hoarder, but I call it, I'm a collector.
Yes.
So when I found, I had a small introductory pro marker set, and I was doing cartoons and just sketches and stuff like that. Uh-huh. And then when I saw that they had 150 in the range, it was just like, I've got to get every single one. And I rest until I got every single one. But the colours are really nice. It doesn't bleed. It's really nice in terms of sketching. This is called Powertex. Mm. And this is amazing. This is a fabric hardener. Mm. And I use a lot of the range of Powertex, especially to do with sculptures. But it can also, with the coloured ones, it's waterproof. So you can do outdoor sculptures. These were my first, these are just Reeves. These are water soluble crayons that I've just put in here, but these were my first. So when you look in my first journals, this is what I use. I went to the store and I saw that there was loads of stuff that I would love to use but couldn't afford, and I had to wait and save up. And then when I saved up, I managed to get the Neo Color and the Para Aquarel and the Ink Tents. Gosh, I love Ink Tents.
Yes.
And the beauty about these is that, you don't have to only use it on paper. These work well on fabric.
Mm-hmm.
And it's really cool. And these I really like. They're called China markers, mm-hmm. but they go on any surface. And I've got some charcoal ones of these, and it's really good that, you don't get your hands dirty, because mm-hmm. I love, I use charcoal and the graphite a lot when I'm doing my paintings. And like you see the one in behind, I would do a sketch of the image and then add to it. Yeah, so washi tape. So when things come out, I kind of got set of washi tape, and then as time has gone on, everywhere I go, I kind of, find another one, and I use this in, when I'm doing my journal pages and kind of laying down layers, I would put these under it. And there's what other things? Paper ephemera. So when I first started out, I collected a lot of paper cards. I used to do, I used to make my own cards. And so I bought lots of paper making materials. And so paper, even handmade paper, mulberry paper. So one other thing, there's loads of other things, but I guess the another thing that I use a lot are baby wipes. So these are really good in terms of, and these are things that you would never think of before. And I know a lot of other artists use it, but I use this in some of my sculptures. So when you put the fabric hardener on, you get with, especially with the Huggies now, I don't know whether you get this all over the world.
Yes.
But it gives you a sheen to the fabric. It shines. Mm. And it's kind of it has a glossy effect where other materials are kind of more matte. So I use this especially with the sculptures, but then in kind of everyday I use kind of wipes kind of in the studio when you're kind of, because Tiara showed us another exercise she showed, Tiara Smith, with working with the Ink Tents blocks and using the wipes. Mm-hmm. But again, also in some of the sewing stuff that I do, once it's dry and it's got all that color on, it makes a really good, item to add either to a journal or to a sewed piece. Mm-hmm. Because I try and incorporate with the fabric stuff, again, what kind of materials do I have around me? When my son left secondary school, I had all his school uniforms. Mm. So the shirts, the white cotton shirts, it was just like, okay, yeah, we're using that. The trousers, the trousers make really lovely surfaces to create on. So like these are his school trousers that I just covered in gesso, uh-huh. and then started to paint. And then, you know, so you can write on it as well, you know, once it's got gesso on. So allowing myself just to kind of play with, you know, a lot of the materials, especially the recycled stuff that you think I'm going to throw this away, or it's not good enough to give to a charity shop because it's too tatty. Why not use it in, you know, and save yourself some money?
Yeah.
But then when you think about, you know, when you think about a lot of the supplies that we use, like I go to the hardware store a lot as well, because you can pick up a lot of those supplies a lot more cheaper than you would if you brought it in an art store. So
yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
Awesome. That is a great list. And I'll make sure I write the list out for folks in the description. So Amanda, I can't even tell you how this has been so amazing to talk to you, to listen to your process, to hear all the many ways that you have empowered yourself creatively. I am in awe, seriously. If I wasn't before, I really am now. and so I am so forever grateful and thankful that you show up the way you do, and you share so generously of your art and your heart. And so thank you for doing that. As you start, as we wrap up, one last question for you. What kind of advice would you give to someone who's just starting out, whether it's in art journaling or just on their creative journey? What kind of advice do you have for newbies?
I would say, play and play some more. Don't restrict yourself to what you feel, you know, like I want to do this one particular thing or that one particular thing. Just try and play and experiment. Experiment is a big thing. I would say that, you know, go online and look at what other people are doing and experiment with some of their techniques. And as you experiment and try what they're doing, you know, like some people say, you know, some people want to draw exactly like another person, mm-hmm. and will take a class and want to draw that picture. Mm-hmm. I mean, I try and encourage people to find your own style. But when you say that to somebody, it's just like, what does that mean? Like, you know, for years I struggled with that. How do I find my own style? Mm-hmm. But it is through, you know, copying, mimicking, finding out what it is from other artists you really like. What technique do they use that you really enjoy? Don't try and reinvent the wheel. Don't say, you know, I've got to be this unique person that, you know, has created this own style, because everything's been regurgitated. Everything, you know, like, you know, we're copying, you know, from centuries ago, we're copying techniques and building on them and stuff like that, and we are finding new ways to kind of use technology and use our art. And I would say as well, if you're feeling like, because sometimes you can go online and watch other people and you can come away feeling down, and so I would say switch it off, turn everything off. Because I do that, you know, sometimes you start then comparing yourself, and you mustn't compare yourself to anybody else's journey. You must just show up. The thing is to show up for you, to play and to practice and to find little hints and tips that will keep you motivated, because you're not always going to be motivated. Just be realistic with the time that you can spend. Nobody has long stretches of you know, hours and hours. Mm-hmm. So if you've got 15 minutes, be there for yourself for the 15 minutes. If it's 5 minutes, 5 minutes. You know, you can flick through a magazine, you can flick through an art book, you know, you can be inspired by somebody else's space. You know, I've got a magazine, Where Women Create. I'm so always inspired about where other women create, but when I look at my own, I'm just like, oh my gosh, why is it so cluttered in here? But it's just like, that's me, that's my space. So, you know, I definitely encourage you to, you know, as you go along, you will find your voice. Don't worry about it now, and just play and just find other people that are, I was going to say singing the same song as you, but, you know, are willing to play as well. And if you can't afford the materials, you might be able to, you know, you might have one set of materials and a friend might have another set and you can join together. But nobody just suddenly has, you know, loads, you know, an art room full of stuff. So if you can only afford to buy one thing, buy that one thing and build on it. Treat yourself to something that, you know, like, as I said, you know, I will go to the hardware store, go to the dollar store, find out, you know, what's there. But I do also invest in myself. And so see it as that. When you can afford to, you know, you save up and buy something that you've always wanted to buy, do that. And, you know, take your time. And just, yeah, you know, just have fun and just, you know, there's so many also as well, you know, people offering free sessions, free courses, free, you know, so just dive in and before long, you know, you'll be, you know, doing the same thing yourself. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, thank you. That is so awesome. So Amanda, is there anything else you want to tell us about? Like, is there, how can people take classes from you or work with you or just experience your art and what you do in the world? How do we connect with you?
Well, I'm available on, I've got my blog, realityartscreativity.blogspot.com, obviously. I've got a website. I've got two websites, realityarts.org and realityarts.co.uk. I'm on Instagram, Pinterest. You can connect with me. If you go to my blog site, I have this pop-up thing so you can leave your name and email address and sign up for my newsletter. Mm-hmm. In the new year, I'm going to be working on a course. I'm going to have a course come out, and it's about like I said, you know, like dipping into that well, having those things that I know is my toolkit, that wherever I am I can take it, wherever I'm, you know, I can be inspired and encouraged. And it's basically, you know, finding, like, you know, use what you've got. You've got a camera phone. If you've got a camera phone, you've got, you know, so finding the things that we've got in our supplies that we can use and the way that we can develop things. And it's called Filling Your Well. And it's going to be like a 21-day course of finding ways to fill that creative well so that when you are feeling down, you can pick yourself up. And then the other free thing that I'm going to be doing, so sign up for my newsletter and you'll find ways, is going to be 25 ways to fit art and creativity into your life. Nice. And so I should be done with that, because I'm going to have like a booklet downloadable and mini kind of videos in which you can kind of say, okay, utilize that, and okay, let me try that. And there's going to be variations, so it's not one size fits all. It's take this, fit it to how you feel you can work with it. Mm-hmm. So I've got the websites, the blogs, and the two courses coming up. So either way, if you sign up for my newsletter on my blog, you'll be able to find out when the courses start, and yeah, we'll be promoting it.
Absolutely. Yay. I love that. So we will, we'll make sure that you guys have all the links you need down below so that you can connect with Amanda in all the many ways that she shows up online. And if you are not in the Journey Within, you've got a few more months, depending on when you're watching this, you can jump in, because Amanda has taught multiple lessons in this, because she's one of our core instructors. And so you can experience her in that way as well. So we'll put her link for the class down below as well. So Amanda, again, I am thrilled and grateful and thankful to you for allowing me to interview you today. It has been a treat and a pleasure, and I can't wait to see what happens in 2017, what all you're working on.
Yeah, well, thank you for having me, and it's been a blessing, and I know that other people will be blessed by all the work that you do. I've seen the videos that you've done, they are really encouraging and inspiring, and there's always a gem that you take away, you know. So that's another thing, you know, when you're starting out, you just need to be around people that are just, you know, sharing. And that's, you know, there's room enough for all of us to share. So, yeah.
Yes, room for all of us. So come on over with your creative selves, and we will see you back here soon. Thank you. Mwah.